What is up, guys? It's your boy, Skinny Cactus. Thank you so much for watching, and today we are going to be discussing the best gear to be using when the Season of Opulence launches. Now, this is very important to know for several reasons. Number one, you're going to be leveling fast and furiously, and so you're going to need to know what to infuse as well as what loadouts you should be using, and normally, there's not really a point to make this video because the PvE meta was well established, but a huge wave of massive exotic nerfs is hitting the game, and so the PvE meta is going to be changing drastically the second Season of Opulence starts. These are things that, as far as we know so far, are unaffected by these nerfs and probably going to be the next kings of the PvE meta. Now, of course, the meta may change with the introduction of new exotics and Season of Opulence gear, but that is not gonna do you any good if you're trying to level up right off the bat, if you're trying to do Menagerie, if you're trying to do that day one raid. And so, let's get started. And let's get started here by looking at the exotic weapons that are gonna be safe bets to run. First off, we have a weapon that I've been very impressed by. I really love using the Arbalest Linear Fusion Rifle. So, first and foremost, this thing is in your kinetic slot, and it has exotic perks that make it very good against shields. That means that your entire loadout, because you have this thing in your kinetic, then your energy, you have an energy primary, is going to be fantastic against taking down shielded enemies. If you're running something like the Crown of Sorrows raids, likely the shielded enemies are going to be the more powerful guys. Running this means that no matter what you're using, you can deal with those guys. Also, it outputs a ton of damage, like a ton of damage. It can take down raid bosses, no problem. I've just been nothing but impressed with this thing. Also, being a special weapon, if you're relying on your heavy for damage, we all know you can get screwed out of heavy drops, no matter how many heavy ammo finders you have. Special seems to be a lot more abundant and a lot more consistent, so that's a reason to use the Arbalest. Moving on from there, another fantastic exotic, we have likely what is going to be potentially the king of PvE damage output, the Outbreak Perfected, especially if you do have the catalyst for it. This thing does more damage the longer you shoot at an enemy, and even though it's just a primary weapon, its damage output is capable of taking down entire raid bosses. Like we said previously, heavy can be a bit tricky to find. Special is more consistent, but not perfectly consistent. Primary ammo is nearly perfectly consistent. So if your damage dealing weapon is a primary, that's insanely beneficial. You're always gonna have ammo going into a damage phase. Your DPS is going to be remarkably consistent. And then you can, you know, rely on special and heavy to take down groups of adds, higher power level major adds, and so on. The Outbreak Perfected is already fantastic. It's not being touched by nerfs so far, so this thing seriously, I think, is gonna make appearances in a lot of raid loadouts. Moving on from there, a weapon that really isn't being talked about too much, but I think is quite good, is the Cold Heart Exotic Trace Rifle. This thing does more and more damage the longer you shoot it at an enemy, very reminiscent of something like the Outbreak Perfected. This is actually a very good weapon. It can take down raid bosses pretty, in fact, this used to be one of the best weapons to take down Kallus, and actually, Trace Rifles in general, including the Cold Heart, received pretty sizable buffs not too long ago. They were just overshadowed still by stuff like the Whisper of the Worm. Well, the Whisper of the Worm is getting nerfed, so the Cold Heart could carve itself into the new PvE meta. Now, similarly, we have another exotic trace rifle. This one is for PlayStation users, the Wave Splitter. Now, this thing is actually capable of outputting more damage in a short period of time than the Cold Heart. If you are getting orbs, one of its perks makes it so that when you do get an orb, it goes to the max damage power level right away. So again, this thing is going to be remarkably consistent because it's a special weapon. It's going to be fantastic against adds, and it's not going to run out of ammo incredibly quickly, and it can damage bosses. Both the Cold Heart and the Wave Splitter could be good ways to hedge your bets for damage output. Also, something like those two guns is going to be very good in so many scenarios that running it in like the Menagerie could also be a very good idea. Now, moving on from there, another great special weapon is the Jotun Fusion Rifle. Now, fusion rifles themselves are getting some massive buffs. Unfortunately, the exotic ones, none of them are buffed more than 5% in damage. But the Jotun was already outputting a pretty significant amount of damage. It shoots too slow to be an absolute menace in terms of DPSing a raid boss, for example, but it certainly does enough damage to take down majors, and it can be fantastic against groups of enemies taking down multiple red bars at the same time and leaving lingering damage over time to help you defend a zone, for example. I already liked using this, and it just got potentially 5% better, and its competition certainly got worse. Now, moving on from there, we have some heavy weapons, and first off, we have the Prospector. This thing is already one of the best damage outputting exotic heavy weapons in the entire game. It already rivals stuff like the Whisper and the Sleeper and so on, but it's not getting nerfed. It got a recent buff with grenade launchers, and it's not being touched so far that we know. So if this thing was already hanging with the big boys and the other big boys are getting nerfed and this isn't, I again expect to see a lot of prospectors being used when Season of Opulence launches. It's very, very good. Moving on from there, another weapon that's good for one member of your fire team is the Tractor Cannon Exotic Shotgun. Now, this thing is terrible at DPS itself, but what it does is that when you hit an enemy with it, you're gonna do 30% more damage with everything and 50% more damage to that target with Void for 10 seconds. The Tractor Cannon is already used in several DPS strats, and it could be used again. One person, again, running this weapon is going to significantly increase the damage output of your entire team. Moving on from there, another heavy weapon here, the Legend of Acrius Shotgun. So, kind of like the Prospector, not as good as the Prospector in terms of damage output, but this thing, you know, is kind of hanging with the big boys. It outputs a ton of damage per shot, and yet again, it's not being touched, but its competition with especially the Lord of Wolves is being touched. So with that, the Legend of Acrius may now be the best, you know, shotgun for damage output. And again, it's already seeing a certain amount of play, so it's a pretty safe bet and a very powerful weapon, and also very good against specifically majors. One shot can take out most enemies or damage them so significantly that a follow-up shot or a melee or whatever can kill them. Next up, our last exotic weapon here is the Darcy. This one, I am very positive, is going to be one of the best DPS weapons in the game next season. Why? Because it's already one of the best DPS weapons in the game. In fact, when we tested out exotic sniper rifles versus Riven, the Darcy outdamaged the Whisper of the Worm with whispered breathing. That's how good the Darcy is. So, why isn't everyone using the Darcy already? Well, it doesn't get infinite ammo like the Whisper did. But now, the Whisper isn't going to get infinite ammo, so there's really no reason not to use the Darcy, and again, there's been no nerfs announced for this weapon so far, so it is going to be near the top of the new meta. Now, another weapon I want to mention that isn't an exotic is the Loaded Question Fusion Rifle. Its archetype of legendary fusion rifles is getting a 30% damage buff against PvE combatants. This thing was already able to take down Kallus very easily and take down other raid bosses and strike bosses. It's already a pretty highly used, very powerful weapon. The fact that this just got a 30% buff is honestly insane. I see a lot of people running Outbreak Perfected with Catalyst, the Loaded Question, and then maybe a rocket launch with cluster bombs or something like that as their raid loadouts going into Crown of Sorrow. This thing honestly is going to be a big contender next season. But moving on from there, we have some exotic armor pieces. Starting us out here on the Titan, the first one we have is the Syncoseps Exotic Gauntlets. Now, these were and still are a very good option to use. They make it so that if you're surrounded by enemies, which happens pretty much all the time you want to use your super, you're going to have a pretty significant damage buff when you're using that super. Using the Synchoceps, you can already take down raid bosses, especially Eater of Worlds, like a bunch of Titans with Synchoceps and Hammers can just demolish that guy. So potentially it's going to be another good thing to run, especially because, you know, if you are a Titan, you're likely going to be in that subclass to use your melting points. So consider the Synchoceps. Moving on from there, some more Titan Gauntlets here. The Doomfang Pauldron. Now, these, I think, are going to shine because most of the exotics that get your super back, like the Ursa Furiosas, are being nerfed. This does not help get your super back, but rather, when you do get a super, it helps you make the absolute most of it. You throw shields, and when you do, you get super energy back. So you can technically extend your super infinitely with the Doomfang Pauldrons. As long as there's enemies to kill and you're killing them with shield throws, you will stay in super, again, technically indefinitely. So because there's not the option of using a Warlock with the Skull of Dire Ahamkara and Cataclysm Nova bombing a bunch of adds, getting their super back, doing it again, getting their super back, doing it again, it may end up being the Sentinel Titan with the Doomfang Pauldrons just constantly using a super for, like, you know, 7 minutes straight, dealing with a large group of enemies, especially maybe in Menagerie or in the new raid, whatever it's going to be. Now, moving on from there, on the Warlock, firstly, we have the Crown of Tempest's exotic helmet. Again, the things that get your super back are being nerfed, so the stuff that makes the most of your super, like the Crown of Tempest, is gonna, I think, start to be very good. This makes it so that your super is extended massively, and when you get arc ability kills, it increases the recharge rate of other arc abilities. This especially goes well with the fact that Stormcaller was buffed pretty recently with Arc Week, and now it can do 150% damage as it gets near the end of its duration, as you kill more enemies. So yeah, Crown of Tempest, I think, is going to be fantastic if there is activities that require you to clear out a ton of low-level adds. Moving on from there, we have the Geomag Stabilizer's exotic leg armor. Again, this is one of those exotics that is kind of already seeing a decent amount of play right now. It's just overshadowed massively by the Skull of Dire Ahamkara. So once that gets nerfed, this, I really do think, is going to rise to the new PvE meta. Firstly, it extends your Chaos Reach massively. It allows you to output a significant amount of damage. It allows you to clear out a whole room of adds because you can just use your super for so long, just kill a ton of guys. But also, it might as well read, get your super back 20% faster, because once you're at about 80% charged, running will significantly increase your recharge rate and you'll get it in just a matter of seconds. So you'll be able to use your super more often overall when using these exotics. It's already good. It's gonna remain good. Moving on from there, Lunafaction Boots. Now, I've gotta mention this, especially for new players out there. This doesn't look like an incredible ability, but it lets you reload weapons automatically when in a Well of Radiance. If you are running the raid, if you are doing probably Menagerie, you want at least one person as a Warlock with Well of Radiance with Lunafaction Boots. That is what you use on pretty much every single damage phase ever for all time, and it's going to remain that way when the new season launches. Now, moving on from there to the Hunter. Firstly, we have the Celestial Nighthawk. This helmet makes it so that all six of your golden gun shots are condensed into one massively high damaging shot. It's already a great exotic to use for DPS. It's already in the meta. And importantly, I think it's going to get much better because somewhat recently, and people kind of forget about this, they added the ability to get a little bit of your super back, 30% of your super back, when you get a kill with it. So that means that, especially with things like even the Shards of Galanor are getting a bit of a nerf, the things that get your super back, like the Orpheus Rigs, they're not as good anymore. The Celestial Nighthawk, as we know so far, is not being touched, and it does get a decent amount of your super back. 30% back is kind of what the Shards of Galanor often do. So why not just use the Celestial and drill a hole into any major's head you see, get 30% of your super back, and then save it maybe for a boss fight. Like, honestly, I think it's going to see even more play next season. Moving on from there, another really fantastic exotic is the Radiant Flux exotic chest armor. This basically makes your arc staff last longer. That's about it. Again, it's more about now making the most of your super rather than getting it back. And just like with Stormcaller, arc staff got significant buffs with Arc Week. Like, people are taking down Riven with arc staffs now, just smashing the crap out of her hand. That's how good your arc staff is. And so Radiant Flux was already a key part of the meta back in vanilla Destiny when arc staff was just insane, and arc staff is back to being kind of insane, so expect the Radiant Flux to be really, really good now. And moving on from there, as for kind of general tips for your loadout, we are again focusing on PvE, so armor with heavy ammo finder and special ammo finder. I really, really like having more special ammo. Being able to use those weapons more liberally is fantastic for taking down the more powerful enemies. But being underleveled isn't just about damage output, it's about receiving more damage as well. So something very important is these mods, resist mods. If you have minor, major, or even boss resist mods, they reduce, each one put on your armor reduces damage taken by minors, majors, or bosses by 15%. You get these from the brand new Gambit armor sets. So if you want to farm these, just farm tier 1 Reckoning, put in a weak mote, and that armor that you get can give you these super rare but super powerful armor mods. Now, as for weapons in total, it's really more about the role you get. It's pretty pointless in me saying, yeah, the Kindled Orchid is a good hand cannon if you have a trash role. So your best stuff, and I would highly recommend your masterworked stuff. Like, don't forget about how important it is to generate orbs on multi-kills. So make sure you're trying to infuse your masterwork stuff upwards, because being able to produce more orbs for your entire team, getting more supers overall, is very, very good. And because it's so taxing on your masterwork cores to infuse stuff all the way up to masterwork, a lot of people are just running without masterwork weapons, but luckily there's sources to get them. Stuff like the breakneck, stuff like the horror story, if you still have them in your vault, it could be a good idea to infuse those upwards, just because having a masterwork weapon is so beneficial. Guys, that's it for the video. Hope you enjoyed, found this informative. If you did, please remember to help me out by simply rating and especially sharing this video. If you guys want to see more Destiny 2 content similar to this, don't be afraid to slap that subscribe button. If you guys want to get in touch with me and keep up to date with the latest channel activity, the best way is to follow me on Twitter at @RickKakis. That's linked in the description down below. Again, I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, have a good day.